call the meeting back to order. We'll call the regular council meeting Tuesday, October 11th, 2022, to order. I have one change to the agenda. Under discussion 8.3, Councilor Charlton wishes to have a discussion respecting the development of a policy regarding traffic studies required by the developer when development occurs. And then we'll further define and see what council means by development. Are there any other changes to the agenda? If not, I'll ask for approval of the agenda. Moved by Councilor Gidney, seconded by Councilor Brown. All those in favor? Any petitions to table at this point in time? 5.0, public question comment session. I would ask that if anyone wishes to comment, they give their name, their civic address, and there is a maximum of 5-minute time on this section of the agenda. Yes.
Yes, Mayor Norman, Leon Robertson, College Street in Liverpool. Under 7.2, it's coming up there, the municipal electoral boundary, public consultation, the information we have there, and you have three options there. And I would suggest, and I think you're recommending option number two, where there'd be 7 councillors, and that would be the same number as it is at this point in time, is that correct?
That was the recommendation from the last meeting, yes.
Yes, and that'll be coming up here later this morning.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other questions? Approval of the minutes, regular council, September 27th, 2022. Moved by Councilor Hawks, seconded by Councilor Romero. All those in favor? Contrary? Trucking a bulk salt tender. Dr. Grant. So as you know, every year we put a tender, the region puts a tender out for the trucking of bulk salt. And there were 2 contractors submitted, and $49.95 from Van Dyke Excavation, and Donald Why Not Trucking $60.30. There is a recommendation to be made, and then any questions can be asked of Director Grant. Councilor Romero?
I move that the Council of the Region of Queens Municipality approve the tender PW02-2022-2023 trucking of bulk salt be awarded to Van Dyke Excavation and Trucking for the tender price of $49.95 per metric ton plus HST for the 2022-2023 winter season.
Seconded by Councilor Charlton. Director Grant, anything further to add?
Nothing further, no. Talking with our neighbor municipalities, we're seeing the same increase of about 20% across the board for trucking due to the increased cost of fuel, parts, labor, and stuff.
So $41.50 was last year's, so it's gone up $8.45. Any other questions?
Are there any fuel surcharges built into these contracts, or is this a flat rate fee?
It's a flat rate fee.
Any other questions? None. I'll ask for the question. All those in favor? Contrary? Passed. Consumption of alcohol on municipal properties, all the municipal boundaries, 7.2, there is a recommendation. Package.
I recommend the Council of the Region of Queens Municipality authorize staff to prepare and submit council preferred recommendation of option two for the municipality's electrical boundaries, electoral boundaries for the 2024 municipal election.
Seconded by Council Gidney. So as some of you may be aware in the gallery, if you watch, follow our minutes, which is probably the best way to get region updates, is to log into our website, because notices are published on that website. It is the only guaranteed way to get news about what's happening. So the province requires that municipal boundary reviews are done. Back in, I believe it was February, there was the first discussion. Councilor's task staff was looking at 6, 7, or 8 different districts. They came back at our last meeting with these options. Option two was changed so that, in a way, so that there will only be two councilors representing the Liverpool area. Presently, there are three, if not four, representing that area. So this way it takes it down to two, which is seen as a much more balanced representation of Queens. Any questions you may have to CAO making with respect to this? Councilor Charlton?
So it says here that it has to be a variance within plus or minus 10%, right?
It does, and however, you're always allowed allowances if you can justify the reasoning why. So as an amalgamated unit with a former town, which basically has half of our population, our CAO feels that he can make a balanced argument respecting why there will be more representation from those areas, from those areas.
I do recall that from the last meeting. I just, when I saw these percentages updated, they were, plus 20%, 51, 14, 16. I just wondered if we were stretching that, if that was expected to be a valid argument, given those percentages.
So a question to CAO McNeil. We send all of this documentation to the UARB. And our minutes from our previous meetings, so everything goes to the UARB. Do they then come back and say, no, we don't like option two, this is the way we're going to do it? Like, do they have a final decision, and have they done that before, or do they, but how does that work?
We, so council deliberates on what type of system of governance we want. In this particular case, we discuss 6, 7, or 8 members of council in addition to a mayor. Our responsibility is to present to the URB. They, as Councilor Charlton said, they like to have a plus or minus 10%. It wasn't that long ago, it was plus or minus 25, and they've narrowed it down to plus or minus 10. But there's lots of municipalities in the province that are outside that plus or minus 10 for legitimate reasons, and the URB accepts those. So our responsibility is to decide which proposal we want to recommend. We then present it to the URB, who have a public hearing, probably in the council chambers. It's provided probably a month ahead of time notice to the public. The public can still provide more written comments, more written submissions. They can appear in person and be in favor of or object to it. And then the URB will make a decision based on all that evidence that's presented in their opinion as to what it should be. And they could go along the recommendation, which is option two. They could pick option one, they could pick option three, or they could pick their own hybrid option. They could tell us to come back and re-amend or realign some boundaries and come back with another proposal that shows something different. So the URB has full control over what it looks like at the end. Our responsibility at the outset is to present what we think is what our residents would expect from us and what makes sense for us as far as fair representation for each member of council.
Thank you.
Any other questions first? Councilor Romero,
and will that decision be made right at that meeting?
No, they have 60 days, I believe, after the meeting, of which to submit and provide a decision. There are odd cases on when they have hearings where it's a very simple hearing, they'll make a decision verbally right then. But all of these decisions have all been done in writing, and they have 60 days after the hearing to make that decision.
Any other questions?
way the boundaries were changed to more reflect the values of the communities to make, you know, to make them more community oriented than they have been in the past. So it's a, I think it's a great idea.
Councilor Fancy?
Okay, what we're just voting on here is 6, 7, or 8. We're not talking about the boundary, just boundary distribution, because we've already discussed that, right? I mean, this is only voting on here because I didn't like taking away Bristol away from Milton. We were, there's some different things we're going through right now, and I'm representing them, so I don't like that being taken away. But that's not what we're voting on here. We're just voting on 6.
We are voting on option 2, the 7 electoral districts.
That's right.
It's what's in your thing, and it lists, and it does, it no longer has Bristol as part of the Milton. Milton becomes its own district in itself. Any other questions under this proposal? Councilor Brown?
Maybe we should make it clear that none of these changes take effect until the next municipal election. The sitting councilors now will still represent the areas that they represent this particular time. It's at the next municipal election where the changes take effect.
You are right, correct.
Yeah.
Any other questions? If I'm going to ask for the question. All those in favor? Contrary? One against. 7.3, South Queens Chamber of Commerce has asked for a waiver of policy 58, consumption of alcohol on municipal properties. There is a recommendation within the package. Councilor Charlton?
I move that the Council of Regent Queens Municipality agree to waive policy 58, consumption of alcohol on municipally owned properties at the request of South Queens Chamber of Commerce at Main Street, Liverpool, between Market Street and 255 Main Street on October 13th, 2022, and that the applicant be required to submit proof of insurance in no less than $2 million per occurrence, with the Region of Queens Municipality as additional insured, and copy of the effect liquor licenses from the province of Nova Scotia to the region, and that all municipal, provincial, and federal laws be strictly adhered to.
And then seconded by Councilor Gibney. Ms. Henley, Community Development Coordinator, who's been dealing with the South Queens Chamber of Commerce, do you have any comments or?
I've been talking back and forth with the director of the South Queens Chamber of Commerce. I've to date received one liquor license that's been approved for this market. They are still trying to arrange their insurance, but it's well underway. It was approved.
Questions? Councilor Brown?
So if they don't get the insurance, then that's automatically off the table for them. That's correct.
Any other questions? And then I'll ask the question. And for those in their gallery, you have your thing. This is for the event they're having Thursday night in anticipation of Theater Fest. So they expect to have vendors who will be selling samples of their product. That's the question. All those in favor? Contrary? Pass. Director Grant. So senior staff have been reviewing job descriptions over the last year or so, tidying them up, giving title to positions that were positions but didn't have a title, as in one their grant will tell us about. There is a, each one comes with their own motion rather than doing them as a lump. So perhaps we'll just start with the first one and then discuss that one. Deputy Mayor Hughes.
I move that the Council of the Region of Queens Municipality approve the Assistant Director of Engineering and Public Works job description.
Seconded by Councilor Charlton. Comments on this one, Director Grant?
Nothing specific to this one. I think overall, they will lot of general changes to increase the consistency across the board of all the job descriptions in our department. This one didn't have anything really stood out in particular.
I know a lot of them now have the emergency management planning committee as a requirement. Any questions of Director Brandt respecting this job description? Seeing none, I'll ask for the question. All those in favor? One, and there's a second one coming. Deputy Mayor Muse?
I move that the Council of Region Queens Municipality approve the capital work supervisor job description.
Seconded by Councilor Hawks. Director Brandt?
So this one would be a change from capital works foreman to supervisor. Right now, the job descriptions are written such that we had two capital works foremen and no public works supervisor, so sought to separate those functions, put public works where it belongs and capital works where it belongs.
And these job descriptions are not reflective of increases in pay, they're just reflective of tidying it up so they all follow a similar format. Any questions of Director Brandt? Now I'll ask for the question. All those in favor? Deputy Mayor Muse, you're going to continue?
I move that Council of Region Queens Municipality approve the Director of Engineering and Public Works job description.
Seconded by Councilor Hawks. Director Grant?
Same as the rest, with the addition of the EMO Planning Committee involvement and the after-hours involvement.
Any questions respecting that description? Now I'll ask for the question. All those in favor? Deputy Mayor Muse?
I move that the Region Queens Municipality approve the grounds supervisor job description.
Seconded by Councilor Brown. Director Grant?
The title for this one previously was a little bit complicated, so we simplified just ground supervisor and added some roles with the park inspection program, something that they're doing anyways, but a little more formalized going forward.
Any questions?
What was the job before?
The job title?
Yeah.
Parks, grounds. No, there's three parks, grounds, and something else supervisor.
Any other questions? Now I'll ask for the question. All those in favor? Pass. Mayor Muse?
The Region Queens Municipality approve the groundskeeper's job description.
Seconded by Councilor Charlton.
Same thing, just the involvement with the park inspection program is more formalized duties.
Any questions? And last for the question, all those in favor? Mayor Muse?
I move that the Council of Region Queens Municipality approve the operation manager's job description.
Seconded by Councilor Brown.
Again, more of the same, more formalized maintenance programs for tracking and succession planning.
Any questions? Ask for the question, all those in favor? Mayor Muse?
I move that the Council of Region Queens Municipality approve the operations operator job description.
This is a title change that was previously the operations attendant. Again, same thing with the facility maintenance, preventive maintenance program, and just change the title to be more applicable to the job.
Oh, I didn't have a seconder for that one? Yes, oh, Councilor Gidney, a seconder. Any other questions? All those in favor?
I move that the Council of Region Queens Municipality approve the public works and solid waste facilities supervisor job description.
Seconded by Councilor Hawks.
This would be a change in role from the capital works foreman that's previously titled to the title proposed, separating the duties of those two individuals out and giving them more specific responsibilities.
Any questions? I'll ask for the question. Carrie?
I move that the Council of Region Queens Municipality approve the utility supervisor job description.
Seconded by Councilor Charlton, and this is a new description.
This is a new description that was previously held across the board by non-union union employees and just seeking to formalize their responsibility to make sure we're maintaining compliance with the water and wastewater systems.
Any questions respecting that? Not, I'll ask the question, all those in favor? Passed. Can you come on?
No, we're going missing.
Did we miss the operations operator?
Solid waste clerk and safety officer.
The solid waste, you're correct, there was no one there. So Deputy Mayor Muse? It's a solid, the.
Solid waste.
Clerk and safety officer. Solid waste clerk and safety officer.
I move that the Council of Region and Queens Municipality approve the solid waste clerk and safety officer, job description.
Solid waste clerk and safety officer.
Yeah, and clerk.
Seconded by Council Graham.
And again, finally, just an update in the terminology, consistency in the creation of the park inspection program.
Any questions on those updated job descriptions? Pardon? If not, I'll call the question, all those in favor? Thank you. Community Investment Fund, there is a motion within the package. Council Brown, who's District Crystal Bay.
I recommend the Council of Region and Queens Municipality provide grant funding to Greenfield Community Park Society in the amount of up to $9,406.25 from the 2022-2023 Community Investment Fund.
And that's seconded by Council Hawks. Ms. Henley, a little bit of background information?
Sure. The Greenfield Community Park Society has put forth an application to the Community Investment Fund. They're looking at developing a 3-acre property right in Greenfield. It's behind the Greenfield Rec Center and school and fire department in that area where the ball field is. So they are redoing that. The phase one, they're going to be doing a walking track around the property, and then they're leveling off another part of the property that they've also acquired. So that's where they stand at the moment.
Good to see those community groups being active. Any questions of Ms. Henley? Councilor Fancy?
I remember a few years back we were at a meeting with them on Kitchen Recreation to be able to find what they wanted. One of the biggest things they wanted was a place for seniors to walk where it was safe and level, because the roads are narrow and of course the lights are for posts apart, so at nighttime wasn't a very good place to walk. So it's great to see a community taking, I guess, the bull by the horns and going forward with this. We should be supporting of them.
And it's the beginning of their projects.
Yes.
Any other questions to Ms. Henley? Councilor Brown?
It's not a question for Ms. Henley, but this is a multi-year plan by the Greenfield Recreation Department, and it will tie in with the community center and school out there, which they own the land along the 325. So it will tie all of those properties together to give the community and the schools access to fitness facilities. And I think it's going to be a great project when it's done.
It will indeed. Any other comments before I ask for the question? I'll ask for the question. All those in favor? Contrary? Development agreement to allow the establishment of an automobile repair shop. There is a recommendation. Christine delivered them after the public hearing. Councilor Gidney?
I move that the Council of Region of Queens Municipality adopt an administration policy respecting entering into development agreement which would allow the establishment of an automobile repair shop on properties identified as PID numbers 7007-1782
7026-1383 and 7007-1816, and located at 16 Edward Street in Milton.
And seconded by Counselor Fancy. Any further questions of Director McLeod, or any further comments? Counselor Brown?
I think it's, this is, looks like it's to clear up something that was already established on the property, and the new owner of the property wants to do things the right way. They've contacted the community, and most of the neighbors are in favor of the project. I think it's good for the area, so I think that's a great thing.
Any other comments? Not, I'm going to ask for the question. All those in favor? Contrary? Passed. 7.7. Amendments to municipal plan for the land use bylaw for future land designation. Again, a motion was scurried up after the public hearing. Who wishes to make that motion? Deputy Mayor Muse?
I move that the Council of Region Queens Municipality give a second reading to bylaw respecting amendments to the municipal planning strategy and land use bylaw, which see a change to the future land use designation of PID numbers 7007-6698, 7007-7722, and 7007-680 to service residential, and a change to the zoning of PID number 7007-6698, 7007-7722, and 7007-7680 to multiple units residential.
And that's seconded by Counselor Gidney. The floor is open for discussion. Counselor Fancy?
I forget to say, so if anybody else wants to say first, they'll let them go.
Put your hand.
Okay. Okay. When we first looked at this, of course, the fellow came an unsolicited proposal to buy the land, and it's a region we have to look at. So there's no other way. We can't deny looking at it. So it's brought it to its part where it is today. I think we need to change that procedure. I don't like that procedure of doing it that way. I think we should be doing it differently. But anyway, the way we are is the way it is today. My biggest concerns is there are two, and that was already stated about, and that's the fire department and safety. Deputy Mayor Muse and Counselor Gidney and I met with a couple of fire chiefs to be able to see what they could do or whatever after, and that they had made a recommendation of being able to put a dry hydrant maybe possibly over in Tupper Park, which we go to do the training and everything else. And I said to the fire chiefs, I bring it today. So that would be one of the concerns. I know the salt water could be up in that end. It could be, it can be the dryer. I mean, we'd have to still maintain what we had, but that would have to be one. The second issue, which is even more ongoing, is the safety end of it. Whether there was going to be a apartment complex there, or if it was just going to be leaving it as it is, we have a serious problem there. I've brought that up on a couple of different occasions. I've been to our constituents' office to be able to bring it up. We even tried to talk, talked with Debbie before, and we've talked about moving the crosswalk. And I've gone to Public Works, which was TIR, and they said they didn't have the line of sight to be able to move that. So the other one across from the Western Housing place doesn't have the line of sight either. But we have serious problem there, and it concerns me with
building something there if we don't, if we as a region aren't concerned about the issue ourselves. So what I need to know is to get a, more from here is a verbal commitment from our region that we, number one, are willing to move, to put in a new hydrant for the fire department. And to see if we, because when I brought it up before about safety concerns, it seemed to be that we're okay with it. Well, I'm not okay with it. And they're not going to be any more okay with it when it comes to conflict. But I know when we talked about the place over in Bristol being built, we said, well, we'll look at safety concerns after. No, like, no, that's not satisfactory to me. We have to know that we're going to be doing something now. If we're not going to be doing something, I'm not going for this. And I know you might say, well, okay, this is not the time to say this, but if we don't, if I can't get some kind of verbal commitment of some sort, I'm not willing to vote for it.
Councillor Fancy, you know that it's almost impossible to do a commitment on the fire hydrant without it going through emergency services.
Right.
And the fire departments.
Yes.
So we cannot do a verbal commitment on that. And it is not within our procedures to do a verbal commitment, because a verbal commitment is a motion. It's a motion.
No.
But could I hear other councillors' opinions on presenting a verbal commitment? I know Councillor Charlton is having a wishes to discuss a policy respecting traffic studies, the development of a traffic study when development occurs. Now, the creation of a policy would require our clerk to create that policy respecting when traffic studies be had. We know, for example, in Bridgewater, if a developer comes in, then it's the developer's cost to do a traffic study. $20,000, $25,000, or $15,000, depending on the thing, for a traffic study. Even if we discussed that later and said we're going to request a policy to be developed, which will come forward at this, it will be mute on this instance.
Okay. I understand what you're saying, but it's like as in Bristol. Bristol, we have a speeding issue, and it's a unsafe. It creates unsafe conditions now. And if we built that, and if Francis Harris built that apartment complex over there, it's going to create even more. And we talked about that before. We said, but we're saying we'll wait to see it built and see how it creates, and then we'll see what we can do. I don't want to let this pass, and all of a sudden we build something there that, well, we know we already have a safety issue. So if we're not saying, willing to say, we understand we have a safety issue, and understand that we're going to be, and that's what I'm saying. Well, I want to be more than just saying, okay, well, we'll look at it. That doesn't cut to me now. The same thing with Bristol. I let Bristol pass. I don't want to let this pass.
I'm kind of lost at words, Councillor Fancy, because without reports from RCMP and Highway stating that there is a safety issue,
right,
then it's impossible for us as councillors to all look at you and say we verbally commit that there will be a traffic study. You know that's not the way it works, because everyone could just say, well, it was an emotion, it doesn't mean anything. So that's why I asked for thoughts and views from your fellow council members respecting the suggestion of a traffic study. Councillor Charlton.
So yes, I would like to see some sort of policy moving forward, because I think it would give the public, you know, more background on that not necessarily being a concern, or if it is a concern, how it's being addressed, but in regards to what Counselor Fancy's saying now, when I first ran for my position, most of my area is provincial roads, not roads that we own, and most of the complaints were speeding and safety concerns. And I spoke to our MLA, and she initiated a traffic study for that area to see if it could result in the speed limits being lowered and reducing passing lanes. Unfortunately, that traffic study didn't result in anything that I had hoped to change, but it was completed. So could we not, as a council, ask for, and maybe it already has, so I guess we should ask that first, has a traffic study been done in that area by the province already?
I'm unaware of one.
Okay.
So, well, it could be, but I'm unaware.
I myself have no issues signing my name to a letter for our MLA to initiate a traffic study, because in my opinion, whether this development goes up or not, there's an issue there. So I don't think it's going to be a new one. There's concerns that it could increase that safety concerns, I think is a valid comment. But why could we not ask for that to be initiated? Because I think it has to happen anyways, or it should. So I have no issues with that. That's my opinion on that.
Councilor Gibney?
With respect, the speed limit through there is 50, and there's no passing. So I'm not sure what a traffic study could recommend. Like, I don't know, but I'm definitely looking for suggestions. And that's the problem there. It's not the speed limit and the no passing. It's the people that don't respect the speed limits and then they're staying on their own side of the road. So that's another item, and I'm not sure how deep we can get into that. But it is a concern. There's definitely, that is a concern.
I have a big concern with moving the fire hydrant. You've got two businesses, an existing apartment building and seniors complex that are all serviced by the dry hydrant at the area. If you move it, they're going to be outside of the range. It's going to affect their tax rates, or not their tax rates, but their insurance premiums, because they're going to be further away from a fire hydrant. Which right now you get quite a discount if you're close to a hydrant. You know, you're going to be putting people in older buildings without good fire suppression at risk. And you're going to be putting a fire, you know, they're looking at putting a place where they're going to be sucking salt water into the fire trucks, which is, you know, I can't see that being good for any of the equipment. Down at Tupper Park, it's when the river shut off the dam and the tide is out, there's hardly any water in the river there for them to get. So I just don't see that as being a good option. And, you know, for the safety portion of it, we don't own that road, and I don't think that we should be trying to take parking and access away from existing businesses to create another one. I'm not sure how we go that route. That's not what we should be in the business to do.
Other comments? Mayor Muse?
We met with the fire department, Councilor Fancy, Councilor Kinney and I, and there's another fire hydrant up the river further that needs some maintenance done to it. They weren't saying if we're taking that fire hydrant away, with the apartment building going there, if it does, it's going to have a lot of problems with the trucks getting in there beside each other. So that's why we looked at putting it down. They can use salt water. They have no problem using salt water. Most of the hydrants in my district are salt water now. They, you know, it's not going to be a problem for the way I understand. They have a truck hooked up to it, and then they have to pump it to another truck. And we looked at the Tupper Park because they could get two or three trucks beside each other and keep coming in, and it was a good area to do it. And like I said, the other hydrant up the river further, it's an old hydrant, and I think it has to change to a new type or something.
Just in regards to the fire hydrant, I've supported this proposal to date with the understanding that that hydrant would be accessible to our fire service. So I'm kind of confused as to why these comments have come forward, because my understanding is that there's protection for that specific reason. Anything as for parking with the development has to allow access for fire trucks to be able to get in there. So I just want to make that clear to the public that there's, that's not been a thing that was brought forward, that that would have to be moved if this went in there, because that's not at all how that's taking place, along with the water public access that also is protected under that as well.
Councilor Fancy?
Yeah, a few different things. First off, when this land was looked at and proposed to be sold, the land goes over in front of where the access is to the boat launch and to the dry hydrant. So we would have to be getting something back from him to say that we could get in there. And then when we got the fire trucks over, because they brought a fire truck over just to look at it, and we said, well, they need 25 feet to get down there? No, they need more than that. They got to have one that brings it up into the pumper truck and then pumps it onto the truck. So it's gonna take a lot of area. And if on his original design, it goes to show the parking spots go into that area. But so you could end up, the possibilities of cars being parked in the spot where they shouldn't be, not unless we get some kind of an agreement. But even then, we're going to be limited to what they can do. So it needs to be something. This is a kind of a solution, so to speak, that they would say, okay, if we head over here, we could do it over in Tupper Park and be able to do it. We'd still have access to that. We still have to have access to that, because if it's dry, if the water's too low and things. And as in the comments on what Deputy Mayor Muse said, they were saying up in Milton in a dry hydrant, they have there's multiple pieces put together and it draws in air, and they can only draw in about, I think it's a quarter of the pressure than what it was. So they need new fittings, really, one solid fitting on there that could be able to get the water they need. But also too, we found out, you know, even when they drive up there, because the limb overhead limbs hanging down, the fire trucks even have to go across the road. So it's not an ideal spot up in Milton there to up on that one of the dry hydrant on the west side of the river, because it's hard to get at, and it's not really the greatest spot. You know, they need it, they can. So and as far as insurance and being placed, it's no good if you're trying to create a spot here and they can't get in, then to create over, even with their, as we've seen in the past, when they wanted to do some training and things, they had 5-6 fire trucks there to do training, but they could do that over Tupper Park. You know, they could put all the trucks in there. So it gives them a spot also too. So we tried to extensively look at this. If something's gonna be looked at as a proposal, we want to make sure that everything works. As far as traffic study, I think it's going to be a waste of time myself, because I've gone to our MLA on two or three things, and it's just, by law, everything's passing. It would have to be things that we would have to be thinking of here as a region ourselves, whether it be speed indicators, which I've been a big fan of, and I've got no traction of when I was in Bristol, which could be there to try to slow the traffic down. Other things that we could try to do, which would be a cost to ourselves, to try to make the place better. And even with the parking lot on the highway, if we have to get rid of that and try to help out businesses, whichever we need to do to do things, that's fine. But let's try to look at the problem. And if we just gonna go by what trying to look what the MLA is gonna say, she's gonna say, well, this falls into the jurisdiction, so it's okay. Everything passes. So that's why I can't go along with that. I'm not gonna wait for a
study or anything else, but it just won't, it won't show us anything more than what we are today.
Director McLeod, have you had any correspondence from the fire departments expressing concern about their dry hydrant?
No, not to date. I guess under the purchase and sale agreement, we had a clause whereby we required continued access to that, so it would have to be suitable access to that hydrant.
So therefore, if the fire chiefs determine the amount of space they needed, there's nothing in stone yet that says what that space is?
No, I have had no discussions with them on that.
So does that help that somewhat definite area, knowing that there's no delineated area at this point in time? Anyone further wish to come, Councillor Charlton?
So just for clarification, the fire chiefs will be consulted about the amount of space that they need to access that dry hydrant. That won't be a number that just...
No, absolutely.
Thank you.
Councillor Hawes.
I'd like to say that housing in Queens County is critical. We need to keep that in mind, right? That's 15 more houses, more or less. There's people that are moving in there that potentially come from somewhere else, right? So it's housing for our people.
Any other comments? Any other further comments? Deputy Mayor Muse, you take the chair. I'd like to address some of the comments that I heard at the public hearing that I thought might have been addressed, but anyway, I'll address them. Maybe it's because I grew up in Milton that I'm so believe in the development as it stands. As a child, I can remember a long shoe factory, a Masonic Hall, a canoe and camera club, an old building next door, another old building. I spoke with my mother last night, who spoke of a hardware store, everything within this vicinity. There was no view of the river. And as much as it's great to protect views, that's a man-made falls that was put in there by Nova Scotia Power. We have no guarantee that Nova Scotia Power is going to keep that there. It's not the set of falls that canoes raced over. It's a rolling set of falls. It's a dangerous set of falls. And that is why you don't see canoes and people swimming down over that set of falls. The traffic issues are everywhere. Think about our three-way stop in Liverpool. They're excessive speed. They require RCMP to perhaps set out on some of them. In respect to its present use, and I looked at the future land use designation for that land, which is urban commercial designation as a future land designation. So in our present documents, the future uses were determined as automobile, body shops, convenience stores, farm markets, liquor establishments, marinas, medical clinics, private clubs, duplex dwellings, multi-unit dwellings. I understand people's desire not to have change, but I've also spoken to several people who would not come here today because they didn't want to be ostracized by the community in their support of this. People who live in Milton and are looking forward to the day when they can sell their home and remain in their community. Within Milton, we have a blacksmith shop, we have a beautiful Tupper Park, and we have Pine Grove Park. The falls will remain there, the man-made set that it is. The boat launch will still be accessible. The dry hydrant will be accessible. I will admit that Eric Fry came to see me in my office and wanted to know where in Queens County there could be urban service land. And yes, I knew that was a piece of land that could be readily serviced. Unlike many people's opinion, we do not have available urban service land for development. We're pretty tight on where our urban service areas go. It's my belief that there are more people who support this project and who look forward to increased housing. And the affordable word, several weeks ago, we were invited to meet with the province, several councilors did, and to relay our thoughts about housing. And those present said what most of the councils across this province are saying. In order to achieve affordable, what people are requesting, $700, $750 rent, has to be provincially subsidized by the provincial government. A developer cannot build and rent for anything less in today's market. And that's true, you can't. Anyone who's built. So this council, like all the other councils in this province, have asked our provincial government to please, please, we need subsidized housing. We have many, many people, and we need subsidized housing. At the same token, we also need housing of all calibers. We need single-family residential homes. We need apartments such as this for people who do not want to do yard care. They do not want to plow. They don't want to be responsible for things. They want to stay in their community. So I look at that corner, and it was 20 years ago, and it had houses on it. 40 years ago, it had a whole lot more. 90 years ago, it had two mills. It had a home hardware. It had a hardware store. It had stores and Masonic Lodge. It was one busy, busy corner. It had Legs store on it, gas station. Milton is a beautiful community and it has a beautiful park. And I also think that will be a beautiful place for people to someday live. And who knows, someday those falls may not be there. Because we also know that those aren't going to stay there forever. So, it's my thoughts.
Any other comments?
Motion. All those in favor? Opposed?
Motion carried.
The election of deputy mayor. So you'll have to. There can be various nominations for deputy mayor, and then if there are more than one, if there are two or three, their names, Heather or someone distributes us paper, because it is a secret ballot, is it not? Yes. I'll be prepared for that.
You will be, if there's more than one.
So, floor is open for nominations for deputy mayor. Councillor Gidden.
Would you nominate Councillor Zach Fancy?
Okay. Councillor Hawks.
I'd like to nominate Councillor Dave Brown.
Anyone else? Two councillors.
Jays.
Blue Jays has it. Should come with a ring around the neck.
What?
Should come with a ring around the neck.
Yeah.
You got everybody?
I have one.
Just with the mayor's office. With the mayor's office, yeah.
Okay. With the mayor's office, do this.
We'll just have a couple, 2 minute break, but.
The coffee too, but the saltwater high. What's that, what they were looking? Saltwater. I didn't know that, I
You were out, like they had aluminum fittings.
Yeah. What?
I'm gonna give up.
I don't know that. Yes, it's. I was up here.
You did this thing, didn't you?
Okay. Little pieces of paper that have our web address on it and that Engage Queens link. So if you don't say, you never know what's going on. Because that's the only way. It's in that case. Pardon? A piece of paper with. Okay, so we are back, and congratulations, Councilor Jack Fancy. You are the new deputy mayor. Then, Lost at Sea Memorial Request. So there is a motion. Oh, we need a motion. We need the motion. That goes with the every mayor means.
I move that the Council of Region Queens Municipality approves the selection of Councilor Jack Fancy as deputy mayor for a 2 year term to begin on November 1st, 2022 and expire on October 31st, 2024.
Seconded by Councilor Gibb. All those in favor? Contrary? Unanimous. Lost at Sea Memorial. Several meetings ago, we had a presentation respecting the Lost at Sea Memorial. staff looked at the site. There's some details in your thing that kind of says concerns that they had about just making sure that there's going to be necessary space, trying not to eliminate trees was a priority. And then diversity and inclusion action team also considered, because that is the purpose of diversity and action team. And their concern was that there may well be people who, for whatever reason, from their walk of life or may not be noted on that. And they requested that consultation should take place with Acadia First Nations or Native Council, respecting some wording, even though it is from 1759 on. It was diversity and action inclusion's opinion, their team's opinion, that it should encompass perhaps pre-colonial time and not just colonial on time. So the floor is open for discussion on that, on those matters. And there was also the matter of if something should happen in a historical society, no longer are in existence, then the keeping of a database would revert to the Queens County Museum and not become a responsibility of the Region of Queens. That we would assume the physical responsibility of that, but the database, if the historical society becomes of state as gone, then the Queens County Museum would become the owners of the database and keep that updated. So that's basically what this discussion paper states from a staff perspective. So what is your perspective from council perspective? Councilor Charlton.
I like that there will be hopefully supported the consultation of Acadia First Nations. I think that's really important.
I talked to Linda Riffews about this, and the reason they hit 1759, that was the last data records that they had of anything pertaining to the loss at sea. They don't have a problem with going back, but like I said, it was only records kept from 1759 on.
And I don't think the diversity and action inclusion team didn't suggest that names had to be found. They just would like something in the plaque in the writing that also acknowledges that there are many people who have been lost at sea from Queens. These are those known from 1759, however that would be.
I don't think they have a problem, changing the wording on the plaque or whatever to say that. I don't think it's written in stone yet, a little to say on the
plaque.
Right.
Other comments? Any other comments? Is everyone fine with the, if the Queens County Historical Society become defunct, that it becomes the responsibility of the Queens County Museum to update and keep the database updated and current, the QR code and that, those things? So that's fine. So, Councilor Charlton?
Am I okay to make a motion?
Yeah, we should just simply kind of indicate in your motion that approval will be given with consultation or discussion for...
Just bring it back to the next meeting.
Oh, just bring it back to the next meeting?
Under discussion?
Right.
For recommendation.
For recommendation. Right, that's what I meant.
Yeah. I move to bring this back to the next meeting under recommendation.
Seconded by Deputy Mayor Mews. Understanding that if it comes back as recommendation, it will have things in it about the consultation and the database and those types of issues. Councilor Brown?
Can we ask them to
to discuss with the diversity and inclusion action team to get the wording so that they're communicating before anything is done.
My understanding is they didn't feel comfortable actually coming up with the wording, and that's why they suggested we go to Acadian First Nations and the Council of Nova Scotia and ask them what the appropriate wording would be.
Yeah.
They would take their direction from that discussion as opposed to them trying to come up with the wording and not being what would be appropriate.
And that's even better because you're developing it with the stakeholders that are involved. I like that better.
Any other further discussion? I'll ask for the question. All those in favor? Contrary? So we've received a letter from Mayor Moon in Shelburne. She sent this out to all mayors. Yarmouth. What did I say, Shelburne? I was just thinking Westford, Yarmouth. She sent it to mayors, asking mayors to write, and I don't write without council's approval. And as I read her letter, it struck me that what she's really asking is for us to, and this is in her second last bullet, this is not an issue between the province and any municipal unit. This belongs with the province and the federal government coming up with a plan to fund an international link. So not necessarily a tourism ferry, but an international link. So my question to you is, are you in favor if I write to our premier as suggested, respecting the importance of an international link to the United States for Nova Scotia, because that is what she wants. So that's the question. Are you in favor of provincial and federal governments supporting an international ferry link? Keeping in mind, it could be tourism, it could be forestry, it could be fishing. Currently not the ferry today. This would not be a link for forestry and fishing. But she's referring to an international link. And in my opinion, I think that's the proper ferry for forestry, fishing, export of goods. Councillor Fant.
Well, I always say I like to try to get people who have got a little more experience with me. I'd like to see what our CAO, if he would be willing to give in kind of a comment on how this could or could have not affect us.
Anytime there's more traffic in Queens County or on the western Nova Scotia, it's positive for our businesses, it's positive for our community. And if our residents want to go that way on the ferry, that's their own, I guess, their own provision if they wish to do that. But our concern is coming this way. When I think about it, I don't think of it as very different from, for instance, we put in highways everywhere else in Nova Scotia. We've got the 104 that goes to New Brunswick. We don't think twice about funding it. It just happens to be on pavement. This is no different. This is a highway. It just happens to be on water. And to Mayor Moose's point, we have a ferry that goes from Pictou County to Prince Edward Island. No one's ever questioned that's a good use of money, or from Digby to St. John. No one's ever questioned those, because they are essentially water highways as opposed to actual highways. So I think this is just another one that's, for some reason, has taken a lot of criticism, whereas the other ones haven't for some reason, not sure why. But if you can get, I think they said 40,000 people have come across the ferry. I'm not sure if that's both ways or just our way, but if you can get 35,000 or 40,000 people and we can get half of them coming on the South Shore, that's double our population that's coming, potentially going through Queens County, and our challenge is to get them stopped. But anytime you can get that access to that many people, it's a positive thing.
Councillor Brown.
Over the last week or so, I've had people that know my councillor, that I know from around the province, and I've had contact from people in most areas of Nova Scotia saying that this is a positive for Nova Scotia. We need to get people in. I also know from experience in traveling down through New England that when I talked to people down there in Nova Scotia, when they found out that the ferry was canceled, at the time that it was gone, that they had no intention of coming to Nova Scotia if they couldn't drive here. You know, they all said, we're Americans, we drive where we want to go, we bring our wallets with us, and that's their saying down there in New England, is if they can't drive to Nova Scotia, they'll stop in New Brunswick if they can drive. So it's, I think it's very positive. It drives a lot of businesses, a lot of small businesses thrive on that, and most businesses are making, you know, if they're making a 5 to 10% return on investment, you take 5% of the population away that's stopping at their stores, they're going out of business. So anything we can do to support them, to get people in here, to bring new money into the province is a positive.
Councilor Charlton?
I agree with all the comments made, and I think the letter supports the right thing to do.
Councilor Gaskin?
Yeah, so I always think when we say a link from Prince Edward Island to Nova Scotia, there's a commitment on Prince Edward Island side, and there's a commitment on Nova Scotia side. Well, what I've seen in the past is there hasn't been a commitment from the U.S. side, because they like want to put money, like they didn't want to put money into ports and things down there. Will this make it so that they would make a more of a commitment, or is this just all our commitment?
I'm
not
in on the do's and don'ts of ferry service. Once upon a time, it was a federal commitment. The federal government provided a transportation link for our industries, which also served as a tourism link. And then the tourism industry decided they had to have a tourism ferry. Personally, I think an international link is good.
Yeah.
It does have to be tourism. I mean, we have a lot of fishery and forestry export going that way.
If I may, just to clarify, we obviously aren't privy to the agreement that they've been arguing over for quite some time, but my understanding is the agreement was very clear when it was signed by the province of Nova Scotia that the U.S. Government or the state of Maine, whatever it was contributing a certain amount of money, and that was it. So that was the agreement the province entered into.
Okay.
So it's easy for us to say, well, they should provide more, they should do this or that, but they entered into a good faith agreement with the province of Nova Scotia at the time, and I don't have any information that says they didn't comply with it. But those obviously conversations were private that we're not privy to, but my understanding is those types of things were negotiated.
So even if we agree to the link, we're agreeing to where it meets their shore, and it's whatever the other part of the agreement would be, it can't hurt us. Yeah.
So is there anyone who objects to writing a letter of support for the town of Yarmouth and an international ferry link?
But also, too, this is going to be from, they said individually, or are we going to send this collectively?
This would go collectively from us. They want it
individual.
Also to...
I think it would be better just to send it collectively.
I think better that we send it on behalf of a unanimous council and encourage businesses, is what she asked. We could encourage businesses for, She just sent it out to the mayors. I just assumed that, I just felt it should be shared between all the councils and make a decision, and then we just submit a one letter from the region. Councilor Charlton?
Could we have our director of the economic department distribute this request to our business director? Those on our business director?
We could do that.
Given letters of support before, they've not come with a motion.
That's right. It's just an agreement.
This is just
Yeah, so I'm just, I would like, I guess, some options for council to consider. It would be nice to know what other municipalities do. I know I did speak with the mayor of Bridgewater before, and they put provisions on traffic studies for new developments. I know there was one, a big development proposed last year for King Street, that came with the traffic study. So I think it would just be a good step moving forward to address and be proactive. That way our residents are fully aware, you know, if there is or isn't issues that could be looked at. In reference to the development on Bristol, there weren't many people that were here at the public hearing that were concerned about the development itself. They were concerned about the traffic. So I think this would be an appropriate time to deal with this and just be proactive instead of, you know, wondering if these developments are going to create issues. I think we should be addressing them first off, not after the fact.
So I guess my question to you, Councilor Tarleton, because staff will need to understand what it is they're doing. Mm-hmm. Development of specific types, development of specific units. For example, we're thinking of building a pool or a library. Is it public development? Is it private development? Is it any type of development? And is it only within the streets that we own? For example, the issue that just was before us, the Karinka Park, because we own the land, mm-hmm. So, I mean, we could have asked for a traffic study, but we don't have any impact on that road. So would this only be within the town of Liverpool, within roads that we own?
I don't believe that would solve all of this, because if you look at that development in Milton, we don't own those roads. But I think that's why I'm asking if we could get some information from staff in regards to what some other municipalities do, because our staff have the means to contact other planning departments and gather that information on a guess of what that could look like. You know, obviously it will come with different implications if it's provincial roads and not ours. I don't know all of what we can and cannot do, but I think if we could maybe perhaps bring this back as a discussion with some more contact, then it would give us an idea of, I mean, the rest of council, I'm not sure how they feel about that, but if they are supportive of it, what that maybe looks like.
So you're requesting that staff do research, and I'd say with rural municipalities, because they wouldn't own any of the roads, with rural municipalities to see if they demand any traffic studies, if development occurs in their area, or if it's development of lands they sell, and within towns and regionals, if they require traffic studies and what they look like. So just, and so the time frame, I mean, I assume it's not going to be an immediate time frame, because I'm certain, I assume that would be our clerk.
May or may not, we'll decide that after.
Yeah, but understanding that. So what do other, what's your viewpoint of other councils?
I think a traffic study is a good idea, and I don't think we should limit it to just in the town area. I think we have to consider the areas of Queens County in whole, not just town.
If we can. Yes. I mean, we'll see what other municipalities, and
yeah.
We can't, you know, someone could build something out here, and we could say, well, we want a traffic study, but we don't own that road, so what are we doing? Unless it was our land, we could say before we sell you that 1,000-person golf course, we want to know what land, for, you know, or whatever. So, but we'll just have to do some research and see what abilities municipalities have when it comes to asking for traffic studies. Councilor Brown?
I've got a little bit of a concern that with what we're saying, that a lot of the provincial roads we don't have any control over, and I kind of worried that if we put traffic studies in place as part of the development process, and we're the only ones in Nova Scotia doing it, we're adding another layer of red tape that pushes developers away from any kind of development in Queens. So I think we have to be careful that we don't, you know, we need to protect the people on the roads, but we also need development, and we don't want to put too many red flags up there.
I think that's why Councilor Charlton asked to do some research to see if other. I'm pretty certain if other ones aren't, you know, we're not going to put over due burden, but just to see if other municipalities, what they have, is it only if they own the land and they're selling it for major development? There may be none. It may only be towns that require traffic studies. Who knows? Councilor Gidney?
I was just about to expand on that, that yes, I agree that we've got to know when and where and why.
That's right.
Yeah, with those reasons, and then, sure, no, we can look at it. I think that's very, very valid. Thank you.
Councilor Clancy?
Are we just looking at developments, or are we just looking for, are we looking at the traffic study as a whole? I think like the east and west side of the river, Milton, like I've always wanted to have that just 50 going through there instead of going to 70. Is that the times things that we can be, is this part of this, or is this just for the housing?
I think this is strictly for development purposes.
Okay.
You may recall as your times on council, I mean, speed limit reduction is a huge provincial undertaking. I know there's been, you know, I can think of Route 8.
Right.
From Pine Grove up through, there's, I mean, council tried for years to have a traffic reduction study in that place. And so I believe this is strictly when new development occurs.
That's what I write. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. We had a change on this point.
You had a change on this point. 70, 60, 50, 50, 60.
Yo-yo.
It's a yo-yo through there. However.
Slow down.
So we should have a recommendation from that this come forward at our next council meeting to ask for a no.
Won't be next council meeting. It's going to take
a
substantial amount of work.
No, I know. But do we need to make?
I guess Councilor.
So we just have to have a motion made that this be referred to staff for further consultation with the municipal units in the province to determine when, where, and how traffic studies are done.
Yes.
For development.
So we do need a motion for that?
No.
Just
one suggesting, based on your comment, is you're giving some direction to staff to carry out the research. We'll do the research over the next couple of months. We'll bring it back as a discussion item.
Yes. And just to clarify, because we have rural parts of our area and roads that we own, I would like to see if there are provisions other places that deal with both, considering Bridgewater, obviously they own all the roads.
Right. And that's why I said we'll look to see if rural municipalities have development traffic studies.
Thank you.
Because they would not own the roads. And we'd also have private roads. We have to look at private, public roads. Because I think in Councilor Brown in his district, it's all private road. And the type scale. And we need a motion to move in camera. By Councilor Charlton,